Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
Hey, let's give the Lord praise. Amen. Isn't he great? Worship is great. And this is exciting. We're going to be baptizing in just a few moments at all campuses and every place and every service. So if you came today and maybe you were thinking about doing this, you can go out into the foyer now. They will give you the information. We've got some shirts and towels and whatever you need, so you can do this. So follow Jesus. So I'm going to give you a chance to do that again. So think about that. If you came and you say, "Wow, I forgot all about it," you can still do it. Hey, today we're in Revelation again. Exciting! I'm so excited to be doing this because God promised a very special blessing just for you to hear it and to learn from it, but to take it to heart. And I just am excited as your pastor to be able to do that and share that and dig into it. I've been studying Revelations for 35 years, but this time I'm just taking it a little bit at a time and just asking the Lord exactly what he wants to share, because there can be so much more. But today we're going to be working. We've been on this several weeks now. We've only been getting like one or two verses, but today we've got a few more verses, a lot of information here. But you're going to want to just follow along and keep together. So what I like to do is read the whole passage of Scripture to you, to kind of let you hear it in sort of a big block of context together. But we've been talking about John on this island. He got this vision from Jesus, and we're now starting to hear the very beginning of what he saw and what God told him. So this is this exciting part as we look at it. So let's begin reading, but before we do, let's just pray. Father, I thank you so much for the power of your word. It is living and active, and God, it can change us and transform our very minds and our hearts that we become more like you just hearing it. So thank you, Lord. We bless this. I pray every eye can see you, every ear can hear you, and every heart be transformed by seeing you and knowing you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Revelations 1 and beginning with verse 10. It said, "On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit." What I'm going to do is read through it and then we'll break it down. "On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, 'Write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches.'" And then he lists those: to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And then verse 12, "I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And then among the lampstands was somebody like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet with a golden sash around his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, and as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he had seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance, and when I saw him I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, what you've seen, what is now, and what will take place later. And the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and that of the seven golden lampstands is this: the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches." Let's say that out loud together. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And then he said, "And the seven lampstands are the seven churches." So let's say that together. "And the seven lampstands are the seven churches." You know, Revelation, sometimes people avoid the study of it because they think it's confusing, or it's, you know, they don't understand it. But a lot of what we see, a lot of what we read, if you just open up your heart, it becomes clear. Because even in here, he explains what it was. Because you see these lampstands and you see these, you know, things, and all of a sudden you say, what does that mean? Well, then Jesus comes along and will explain sometimes those key pieces that you're looking at here. And so we take that in as we go. And then as we look at this, that the title of this message is Jesus Writes His Church a Letter. And so this is kind of the key big thought in this, is that Jesus is writing a church his letter. In fact, it would be called his love letter. And let's look at our first scripture there in our point one. Jesus writes his church a letter. In Revelation 1:10, now let's break it down for a couple of verses. It said on the Lord's Day. Now, if you think about it, what I believe that means is the Lord's Day was Sunday. We call it Sunday because it was the first day of the week, and it was the day the Lord rose from the dead. If you go back and you look at, a lot of people think, well, this was the Sabbath. It's not the Sabbath. He rose on the day after the Sabbath because the Jewish Sabbath was from Friday night at sundown till Saturday, so it's all day Saturday. But the Lord's Day, the day he arose, was a day that the early church began to gather. So they would sometimes be fully Jewish and fully engaged in the Sabbath, honoring the Sabbath. But then as soon as the Sabbath ended, they were able to go out and gather together in homes and in places and hear the preaching of the word and celebrate and singing of psalms and hymns and just prayer and worship and all those things. And that's kind of what I believe was happening with John here. John is on this island. He's been banished there because of his testimony we heard last week. If you want to go catch up and you haven't heard some of the messages, go to our website. They're all in there, and you can watch every one of them in high-def video. But what we understand is he was on the island. I heard something this week that it was a punishment. It was like a criminal place. The scholars believe that it was a place of mining, that the Roman Empire was mining some type of material, and that what they would do is they would send people to this island, and then they would chain them to a wheelbarrow, because that's what they pull the ore around. So you got your leg hooked to a wheelbarrow 24/7, and that's one of the reasons you couldn't escape from this island, because it was surrounded by miles of ocean and open water. And also, all the currents pushed deeper and out to sea. So no matter if you didn't have this thing on your leg, even if you were a great swimmer, you could never make it to shore. So it was kind of like you're there till they decide to let you go. So here is John. Imagine him sitting in some little cave, and maybe it's a time when he's reflecting. It's the Lord's Day. He's remembering. This is John, the one that knew Jesus personally, one of his apostles who saw him in the resurrection, remembering that resurrection power and all of its glory. And he's in this place, this time, worshiping him. And that's what I mean. It says there, on the Lord's Day, and I was in the Spirit. Now, I just want to leave a thought with you because I don't know all the answers there. We could spend probably a whole message just, what does that mean? I was in the Spirit. But what it spoke to me immediately was that it's a different state than not being in the Spirit. Isn't that a good, it's just simple, isn't it? You're either in the Spirit or you're not in the Spirit. Maybe there's some other possibilities, but it's a recognizable state that he understood he was in the Spirit. And what I believe he was in a state of worship, and he was in this place where he was connected to the living presence of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. He was sensing his presence. He was worshiping him. He was engaging with him. And out of this engagement, he caught a revelation that has changed the world. And as I think about that, I just want to encourage you, as you are a follower of Jesus, is that take some time on the Lord's Day, which is your Sundays, if you can. And then take some time to worship him. Take some time to be in the Spirit and engage in him and connect with him and love on Jesus and thank him and whatever. You see, I think sometimes we come to church even, or some of us, we're sitting at home and we're watching, we think we're engaging, but we haven't really engaged our hearts. He wants us to engage our hearts, to be in the spirit, not in our intellect, not in just our mind, which he wants us to worship with him, all our heart, our soul, our mind, our strength, but the spirit of God connecting. And so I just want to encourage you, take some time to do that and keep searching, keep connecting until you see and realize I'm in a different position here. I'm sensing Jesus is in the house. Amen. And I don't know about you, but there are moments, you know, sometimes you're singing and yeah, you're doing your thing and it's okay. But sometimes you're singing and your mind is still somewhere else. Have y'all ever done that? But then sometimes all of a sudden you realize, wait a minute, something just happened. I didn't even realize where I was. I must have been in the spirit because something transitioned in my heart. Something changed, something. And all of a sudden, I know I'm in services sometimes and you can feel the presence of the Lord. You know what I'm talking about? Where you don't know how to explain what it is. You just know. Sometimes it makes grown men cry, you know, and they don't even know why they're crying because you're in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Lord. He's in the house and he comes and he promises where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is. Well, that's a mouthful right there. It's the gathering. It's not just being alone, and you can be in the spirit just like John was, but he has a special promise. When we gather, something happens. So I encourage you. When you come to church, or even if you can't come to church and you're still at home, then take the heart conscious to be in a state where your heart is trying, reaching out, not just watching, not just listening, but connecting with the living Lord. Amen. He was in the spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. That whole concept right there, I can just encourage you, go look up the word trumpet and the shout. Remember when we talked about the rapture, it says at the sound of the trumpet, at the loud shout, the Lord will come and we will be captured into the air. I think this was a symbol and sign of that right there. I think it was like God saying to us, this is what's going to happen when the rapture comes. I'm going to shout out and it's going to sound like a trumpet and there's going to be a rising up and we're going to be caught up in heaven. And then you're going to see all the stuff that John saw. So that's why I talk about you, and I'll keep reminding you, we are not going to be on earth when all this wrath and the troubles and the things are coming. We're going to be out of here. Can anybody say amen to that? All right, verse 11. And then he said, write on a scroll. And I put it in your notes there just as a reminder that that's a single document. It's one scroll. It's a long scroll. And each church then was having a part to it. And he says, this write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches. And then he lists these seven churches. And one of them was right down the road here in Philadelphia. Amen. Wasn't that nice? It's still a mess, isn't it? Hallelujah. Better write another letter, Jesus. Need some help. Yeah, Smyrna, yeah. We're right here in the middle of all these churches. Delaware, I knew Delaware was important, didn't you? Jesus land. But he's writing these letters to these seven churches, and he's got a document, but it's being sent. All churches got to see what everybody else. It wasn't a private letter. It was a circulated, open letter. And explaining everything in your life. How many of y'all would just like if Jesus just wrote down everything about your life and then just showed it to everybody? Anybody want to sign up for that? No, I don't think so either. That's kind of was. These were seven churches. They were all located in what we believe is now the area of Turkey. And they were a group of churches. But as you think about this, and all scholars say this, there's some unique things when he said seven churches. Remember what I talked about earlier, the number seven? Number seven, God always had a special, unique connection to numbers. And on the seventh day of creation, remember on the day seven, he was complete. He had completed all that he wanted to in that process of creation, and he rested on that. And so anytime we see the number seven, it speaks to us of God having a completion, a representation of something that is complete. And so let's break this down and kind of like think about what is this, these seven churches are. And I put it in your notes there. Number one, they are seven personal churches located in Turkey. That we, all the scholars believe, Barbara and I, we've been to Ephesus before. We've walked the streets of Ephesus. And we've been in some of those places and seen it. It is a real place. And you can go there even to this day. So there were seven actual personal churches located in Turkey. But they weren't the most famous churches that were always in existence. You remember, the church was already growing and birthed in Jerusalem. The first church began in Jerusalem. There's another church that was listed as Antioch, you know, where they were first called Christians. There was the Church of Rome. Think how powerful and influential that should have been. Churches all over the known world by the time this is being written. You know, this is like John, who probably was a teenager when he was walking with Jesus and being his disciple. The scholars now believe he's probably into his 90s, maybe. So it's a lot of church growth, a lot of churches, a lot of influential churches, but Jesus chose these churches. And we must ask ourselves, why did he do that? It wasn't an accident. They weren't the most famous, the largest, the most prominent. But I believe it's because there's some specific traits that he wanted us to hear about. And that's when we're going to really get interested. So we're next. The lesson, we hope to start getting into the churches in each letter. Seven personal churches. But number two, there's seven periods of church history over 2,000 years. A lot of scholars believe that if you read these descriptions of the churches, one represents the church when it was beginning in the first ages. Then one in another, like several 500-600 years later. Then another one, you know, during the Middle Ages and so on and so forth. And it's sort of a history of church history. I don't like put a lot into that because I don't know. Yeah, that's great. Maybe God wanted us to see how the church would evolve. So there's something there. But that's not the most important thing to me. But number three is I believe there are seven patterns of churches or people, because that's what church is. Church is not a building. When he was writing to this church, it was not a building. It didn't have a steeple and a bell and a little cross on top. These are people that would gather together as followers of Jesus. All who believe in him are called the church. We are the church. Everybody say, we are the church. That's who he was speaking to, these groups of people that happened to be in these cities, and they kind of had a connection because that was their common goal or their life that they were connecting and gathering. But there's patterns and things in the lives of these people, and that's one of the things that Jesus wants us to know too. But he's speaking to his church, his complete church. Because it's seven, what Jesus wants us to know is, this is my letters. And even though they're written to these unique cities, I want you to know this one is for the world. This is for my world church, my complete church, the church that's all over the world and throughout the centuries and for centuries to come. It is the complete church. And since you just said, I am the church, guess what? These letters are your love letters. Amen. These letters are your correction letters. These letters are pointing out things he wished would change in your life. And that's the way you need to look at this. That's what I want you to see. Is that this is a letter written to me. This is a letter that is personally. It's not for Pastor Steve. It's not for those churches just there. This is God talking to me. And if you can just think about it, all of God's word is this way. But here's a love letter from Jesus written, addressed to you. And he wants to tell you about some things. He wants to encourage you about some good things. He wants to warn you about some things that should be changing and getting better in your life. And he wants to warn us that there is going to come a judgment of this world. But you're not going to have to worry about it. You're going to be out of here. So it's an amazing letter. And that's why we want to study it. Oh, praise God. Jesus writes a letter to his church. Number two. Our next passage of scripture, we see that Jesus is revealing that he is the Son of Man. Everybody say Son of Man. You know, we find it in Revelations 1:12 here. Let's read it. He says, I turned around to see that the voice was speaking to me. And when I turned and I saw the seven golden lampstands. Remember, those are the churches. They represent the churches. He was looking at lampstands, but they represent the churches. And among the lampstands was someone like a son of man. And he gives this really unique kind of thing, like a son of man. And I'll show you why that's important. And he was dressed in a robe down to his feet with a golden sash around his chest, all representing garments of priesthood and royalty and understanding. His head was and hair were like white as wool. And I don't think it meant like he was just gray-headed like some of us are. But I think it meant it was like he was glowing, like it was like a brilliant glow around him in his glory that was on him. And his eyes were like blazing fire, and his feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. Have y'all ever been around a large waterfall? You know, and it just almost sometimes it can get so large that it's almost deafening. And I believe that you'll see this throughout the scriptures here in Revelation, that this, it's like a waters, great waters, and sometimes it's like a roar. I think that's what he's hearing, this roar of heaven. I think there's roar of heaven because people are going, hallelujah, praise the Lord. You know, like tens of billions of people are just crying out to God and praising him, and it's like a roar. And then the angels' voices, and then God's voice speaking above all that for us to hear. And that's what we see. But he says, I saw someone like the Son of Man. And I felt like it was important to bring this out. And the key thought of this, let me give it to you up front and it will explain it. But it's God, when Jesus uses this title, and this is another title or a name for Jesus, the Son of Man. And it's a unique title, and I'm going to show you where it comes from and why. But the key thing is that one of the key attributes of this is we realize what Jesus says when he says, I'm the Son of Man. It's saying, I am fully God, and I am also fully man. That I have been born of the woman, I've taken upon you your characteristics. I became man so I could pay the price for your sin. But I am also still fully God. I am this God, the Messiah, who will come. And that's what we understand that he's showing us here. And what he would be doing, see, to us, we read that like, well, the Son of Man, I don't know what that means. Well, to the Jewish people, they knew exactly what he was talking about. It wasn't like hidden or secret because they've been studying the book of Daniel for hundreds of years. And we see this account. Daniel was a prophet, and he had this another vision similar to what John had, very, very close in nature. And he, in writing and describing, that's why a lot of the references you see in Revelation or out of Ezekiel, Isaiah, or Daniel, the Jewish people knew exactly these symbols that he was talking about. And that's why we need to know our word. But look what we see in Daniel 7:13. It says, in my vision at night, this is Daniel now getting a vision, I looked and there before me was one, let's say it together, like a son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven. Now, isn't that a unique? All of a sudden, he sees a vision, and he uses this title. We don't know exactly, other than it's like man and God connected together, the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. And then he approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. You know, that's another term where God and Jesus are called, that's a title from the Old Testament called Ancient of Days. You know, we sang, I think it was just a week or two ago, I can't remember now, but we sing a song and just came back, I think we used it recently, called The Ancient of Days. You remember singing that song? And so some of us are out there like, we're singing along The Ancient of Days, and we're saying, what the world is that about? Well, this is what it's about, and this is where the words are coming from. When you look at it, it says, he approached the ancients of the day and was led into his presence. And then we, part of that song in, he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. Now, what he's speaking of, this person he's looking at is God, but he's also man. He's fully God and fully man. And then look what it says. And all the peoples and nations and men of every language, what did they do? They worshiped him. Now that's a key marker there that he's fully God and only God and the God. Because in the Jewish law, it was very clear in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt have no other God. There is only one God, and you shall not bow or worship any other God. But when people bow down to Ancient of Days, the Son of Man, to Jesus throughout the scriptures, including it when he was walking on earth, when angels bow, when people worship, when people in heaven are bowing to Jesus, guess what? That means he's fully God. He's not just the Son of God. He is fully God. And that's why that sometimes people get the Trinity in their own. How can he be all things? Because he's God. And he can do about what he wants to. Amen? So every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion. Again, an attribute of God. And that will not pass away. And his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Because it's eternal kingdom. And this is what Daniel is seeing. And now Jesus using this term, or even John using this term to describe it, he's having the same kind of vision. And when he does, it's like to the Jewish, like, that's the Messiah. You see, Daniel, everything that Daniel said, he knew this is the Messiah. This is the promised one. This is the one who is going to come, born of woman, but be fully God and come and deliver and save people and everything. So that term, Son of Man, is a very powerful statement of the Messiah who's fully God and fully man. Jesus used this term of calling about himself in several different places, but let me share one of them in Matthew 26:63. It said, this is on Jesus' trial. They're trying to convict him of a crime that they can kill him for. And Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us, if you are the Christ, that promised one, the Messiah, the one that God has promised who would be fully God, fully man, and that will come and deliver his people. If you are the Christ, and then he uses that term, the Son of God, and what is Jesus' answer in verse 64? He says what? Yes. Everybody say yes. Yes. It is as you say, Jesus replied. But I say to all of you in the future, so he confirmed, I am the Christ, I am the Son of God, I'm the Messiah, the promised one, fully God, fully man. And then look what he goes on to say, and you will see the Son of Man. He uses that title from Daniel. You'll see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and doing what? Coming on the clouds of heaven, exactly like Daniel talked about. The same wording that Daniel used, Jesus is now using for himself. And now look what it cost him. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, he spoke in blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, you have heard the blasphemy. And blasphemy is, in this case, is Jesus was being put to death because he was claiming to be God. He was claiming, and only, there can be no other God. He was claiming to be the Messiah and God, Son of Man. And that was everything in his testimony. And that's what we see now being brought back. And what God is doing, Jesus is doing, is everything that you heard in Daniel, guess what? We're going to start seeing that. Everything in the old is now going to come into the new. And that was the reminder there. All right, let's get on. We got lots to do here. Now, number three. Jesus' words would judge the world. In Revelation 1:16, it was saying, in his right hand he held seven stars. Those are the angels of the church. And out of his mouth came a sharp, double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all brilliance. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead, which is what happens when people meet supernatural power and glory. It just like sucks the life right out of you. Then he placed the right hand on me and said, do not be afraid. I'm the first and the last. Another one of his titles, remember. I'm the living one. And really, it's so clear here. I was dead. Remember, Jesus was dead. And behold, I am alive, but what? Forever and ever. And now, and I hold the keys of death and hell. We could probably have camped right in that one, those two verses right there for a lot. But the key thing I want to tell you about is this sword that's coming out of his mouth. You know, we look at this and he's seeing things in visions and God's painting pictures to him. But we know, and the scripture reveals what he's seeing coming out of his mouth. And that is the word of God. Hebrews 4:12 is a confirmation of that. It says, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any what? Double-edged sword. It penetrates even the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and it judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. And the real key that I want to leave here, that's why I really just want to focus on one thing, is that Jesus is speaking the word, and that word will bring judgment. And later on, when we unfold each of these chapters in Revelations, you're going to see, ultimately, judgment is going to be poured out onto the world. And it's Jesus now finally stepping into his final place as God and judge. But the key role of that judgment is not his emotions, not his feelings, not his, but the word of God. And when the word comes out, it's what's going to strike down the world. And it's the word that which you're going to stand under is the standard. And so my really call to you as a pastor is, how do you let the word guide your life? How is the word dictating your path? How is the word manifesting in your life? Do you know the word? Fall in love with the word. Read the word. Don't just come on Sundays to get the word. Get in the word, because that's going to be the thing that we're going to stand before in all of heaven. Line your life with the word. And then number four, we're coming to the last of this in closing, we see that Jesus actually gives the outline to the whole book of Revelation. You can break it down and look at it, and we find this in Revelations 1 and 19. He says this, he's speaking to John, he says, write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand, and that whole concept of the right hand where these angels and churches are, that represents control. That represents authority. The right hand was the hand of authority, but it was also the hand of blessing. And guess what, church? You're under God's authority, under your control, but you're also under his blessing. How many of y'all will receive that? Say amen. That you can see that he is in the midst of his churches. He cares about his churches. He knows everything down to the detail that's going on inside of you at the church. And that he's there to speak blessings and over your life. And then he says, and the seven golden lampstands and the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Now, just here's a thought. You could go off and let's do a study on angels. But you can do that on your own. You can do some research. But this is just a thought to it. That here these churches represent all of church history, all of church, and every one of them had an angel. Now, do we have an angel? And I don't know that we have churches like we do here, because we isolate churches by buildings or names or something. Maybe there's a church in northern region of Delaware, Maryland, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, because I don't think Jesus even cares about state lines. He cares about people. And every place people are, we're connected together in the church in this northern region. That's why I just believe that God's got such an amazing thing in store for this church. But I thought, Lord, do you have an angel that's watching over us? And it said angels are to do the bidding of those who are called and servants of the Lord. And I'm just thinking, angels ready to go out there and do stuff for us. That God sends messages through his angels. See, that's what they do. He wants to communicate. The angel comes down and speaks. Oh, angel, we want you to be here and have your way. Amen? We always think about that. Well, I just don't have time to go any, but I just want you to think and thank God that angels are watching over you. I always pray. I said, Lord, let angels stand guard over my house. Let angels stand guard over my family and break back the darkness and the attack. You got angels. Start asking God to release them on your behalf. But what did we see in the outline? Number one, it was what John saw. Write down what you're seeing. And that's really all in chapter one. That's what this is what I'm seeing. And we see the outline. And then he said, the second part, though, was what is now write down what is now, and that's the messages to the seven churches, which are in chapters 2 and 3. And then he says, what will take place, which is in the future. And that's from chapters 4 all the way to 22. So you wonder, like, what is God talking about? What is he writing about? Well, he tells us what you see, what is now, and what's going to happen. So we can understand, Jesus made it clear, this is what I want you to understand. I've got a plan for you, the church. You know, I'm going to close in prayer, but before I do, I mentioned maybe you're here today, you're at Middletown, and you didn't come prepared to baptize, but now you know you need to be water baptized. And I want you to be dismissed right now. Go out into the foyer. There's workers there. They're going to give you some t-shirts and some things and get you ready. And all those who are going to be baptized, you should be ready. And in just a moment, we're going to line up here on your right, but my left. You're going to come down this side and line up right along here, because we're going to go straight from here to worship to baptism. There's not going to be any delays. But if you haven't come prepared, but you want to do it, you can leave right now. You can, before we get to the end, you'll be ready. So don't make your excuses. You forgot or whatever. You don't have any excuse. It's just you and God. Amen. You'll be standing before him one day and he'll say, well, why didn't you follow me? And you'll say, well, I just didn't want to get my hair wet. All right. What do you think he's going to say about that? Let's close in prayer. Maybe you're here today too. You've never given your life to Jesus. And you're realizing he is real. Revelation just shows him. You see him so clearly. You're starting to understand him and know him. And my prayer is that as you know him, you'll also love him. So maybe you're here today or you're watching online and you need to make Jesus Lord. If that's the case, you just pray with me saying, Jesus, I need you. I need a Savior. Forgive my sins. Come and fill me with your Holy Spirit. Let me be in the Spirit so that I might follow you all the days of my life. And Father, I pray for them and every one of us that have been following you, some for 50, 60, 70, 80 years. Whatever, Lord, it's all about you. It's all about you. We love you and we praise you. We ask you to help us see you and live for you every day of our life. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the church said, amen, amen. All right, come on. Those being baptized, line up. We're going to just worship and celebrate. Y'all sing your hearts out. Cheer along and just encourage the people.